Good morning and welcome once again. You've got to hear Michael Parker, and I'm going to introduce Michael by reading to you the last page of his lovely book, Oysterville, A Quiet Place in Time. A couple have asked, is the book going to be available? And Michael did not bring any because he didn't want to turn this into a white book selling event, but they would be available. So we're kind of talking with him maybe to just jot down name and address, and we get it, and Michael will get it too. Michael Parker was born October 16, 1935 at LaGrange, Oregon. Moved with his family to Portland in 1942. He graduated from the University of Oregon in 1960 with a Bachelor of Landscape Architecture degree. During his 25-year career in private practice, he designed more than 900 projects and was chairman of the Portland Design Commission. Projects he designed received awards from the American Society of Landscape Architects and the American Institute of Architects. Parker closed his landscape architecture practice in 1984 and began a new career as an aerial photographer, flying alone as both photographer and pilot. Assignments have been completed throughout the United States and England. In 1977, he wrote the Oysterville Historic District Ordinance that preserved Oysterville as a historic remnant of the 19th century Willapa Bay oyster industry. From 1978 to 1991, he served on the Oysterville Design Review Board. In 1986, Parker moved permanently to Oysterville, specifically to contribute professional skills and experience for preserving and protecting the fragile Willapa Bay estuary. His second book to be published by the Columbia Land Trust is about the Willapa Bay estuary. Parker and Maggie, his Australian shepherd, live in the house he built across from the wetland meadow connected to the bay. Please welcome Michael Parker.
I have to tell you, one part of this introduction is that for the last 2 years, starting in 2014, I taught the middle school photography class. So this is the first group that I've talked to since the last time I had 12, 13, and 14-year-olds. And I kept looking and I'm saying, I think probably we may have one kid here that's under 60. And there she is. We've been waiting for you.
Oh, my God. Sorry.
That's all right.
Find a seat. I'm sitting over here. Sorry.
What I think that I'd like to talk about, and I made notes, but anything that you see and probably anything that you are aware of with anybody that works in a creative mode, are going to be, whatever it is they produce, whether it's photography, whether it's painting, and I'm thinking of Eric Weigert that grew up in the area, there's going to be origins and previous experiences that they have, and they're not going to be aware of it at the time. And so I write a lot of letters, an inordinate number of letters. I've got friends that have got more than 500 letters that I've written. I have others that say, you know, I've got 200 or 300 and I've saved them. But what it has done is it gives me an opportunity to write about those kinds of things that I've either experienced. I've lived alone for the last 35 years, so the communication that I have is really through written letters, some emails, but I still prefer to write a letter, put a stamp on a letter and put it in the mailbox. But when I started putting notes together, and I've given talks before, this is a more intimate group because you're people that are familiar with the area. I can kind of trace the very beginnings of this, and I have seem to have a good visual recollection of a lot of experiences and places, so I'm going to go through. And then we'll talk a little bit about landscape architecture, and I have not been functioning in that kind of a professional capacity since 1984, so there's a long time there. But I have perceptions of that now that probably come with the additional maturity and the experience of what I've learned living here and also with the photography that I've done all over the United States. So if I go back to Diane's original introduction, my first recollections go back to that period of 1937 to 42. For some unknown reason, I've got visual recollections of things that my mother would say, you can't possibly remember that, you were only 2 years old. So, but I do seem to have pretty strong visual recollections for the time that I was probably almost 4 years old. And at that point, it just takes off and it's like a running video. In the letters that I write, almost everything has got some kind of a visual reference in it. So in terms of my own history, I can remember specifics. All of a sudden, a week ago, I said, wait a minute, we're going to meet today, October 6th, 2016, exactly 36 years ago today, in the dark. I took off the airplane. It was the first aerial photograph that I had taken. And I said, I didn't understand it, and it was aerial art. But I always tell people that that is probably one of the most current parts of this where I say expect the unexpected. The curiosity was triggered by that. I was out the next day, and then pretty soon I started flying more often and doing it. But going back to the early background, which I can kind of trace to a lot of this, lived in Echo, Oregon, rural area, small town. My father was the principal. I went over to the schools. My parents had books, and I was always given books because it was associated with the kids that were going to school. So I started reading when I was young. My mother would spend time with me. I had a younger brother that's about 3.5 years younger. I, being the first one, got that attention. So I was almost 4 years old when he was born. I went through the first grade at Echo, and then in 1942, after the war had broken out, we moved to Portland. And my father had taught summer school at the University of Portland for several years. That was kind of an introduction beyond the public school. So when I started in Portland for the second grade, they wanted to skip me to the third grade. My parents said, I don't think he's emotionally ready to be skipped. And so they kept me in the first grade, or they kept me in the second grade, which was a repeat. And so my orientation began to change. Now, when I was in the third grade, or the fourth grade, it was 1944, February of 1944, somehow or another, the doctor picked up that I had a sinus infection. My father apparently had rheumatic fever when he was a kid, and there may have been something that they had picked up about that, but what happened was they pulled me out of school in February of 1944. So between 44 and between February and August, I spent a lot of time by myself. I didn't have other kids visiting me. I was upstairs on the second floor. They brought meals to me. I felt great, but I had a radio. And so I listened to the radio. There was another friend of the family that had a school supply business. His name was Al Fonder. And Mr. Fonder used to drop off drawing equipment, papers, when I say equipment, it was pencils, pastels, watercolors. I had this whole abundance of art supplies, and I didn't know how to use them. So I had to kind of start sorting through, how do you do this, how do you do that? And I remember that at one time, and I don't know whether this was out of boredom, but I started sketching what I saw out the window on the north side of my bedroom and then out the east side. And so as I look back at that, those were probably the first connections that I made with anything that had to do with architecture. On February 7th, 1947, it was on a Saturday night, maybe it was a Thursday night, I can't remember, but a friend's father took three of us to the midget auto races out at Jansen Beach, but it was 1947, and the only thing I don't recall is whether, August 7th, whether it was on a Thursday or a Saturday night. So I have to kind of describe that. Here it is. I've never seen anything like that before. Grandstands are packed. It's a quarter mile dirt track. And there was Carl, George Shirley, and myself. So there are just three of us. In the first place, the noise, the lights, and it's a production. Never seen anything like that. But what happened out of that was that I said to myself afterward, because you watch these cars on a quarter-mile track, and they're, you know, they're really just virtually within inches of each other, and there's probably 20 or 25 on that main event. But when I walked out of there, when I left, I said, if I learn how to drive a race car, I will never, ever be afraid of anything in the world. So these are these kind of little things that are unexpected. We'd go down and go, are any of you from Portland? Okay, well, there's enough of you there. Driving down Northeast Broadway, and when you're heading towards town, heading west, on around 15th, there was a shop. It was a garage. It was brick, and it was set back from the street, and so there was parking here, and there was parking over there. We'd go by, and my folks would be driving by, and I'd look over, and here were midget racers sometimes outside, and I thought, this garage has got something to do with racing. So I rode my bike down, and here was it was a midget that was out by this power pole. So I got off my bike, and I put it against this other pole, and I got out, and I'm walking around, and I'm looking down in the driver's cockpit. Now, a midget racer were powered by either Ford V8 60s or Offenhauser engines, four-cylinder Offenhauser engines, and those cars were probably from the wall out to here, front engine, driver's exposed. There might be a small roll bar in the back, but these things were absolutely lethal. There were a lot of fatalities. So I looked over, and there's a big guy, white coveralls on, and he's walking out in the garage, and I thought, uh-oh, he's going to tell me to get out of here. And he walked over, and he's about, and I was here, standing here looking, and I hadn't done anything. I didn't touch anything, because back in those days, you didn't touch anything when you did it. So I was standing here, and he walked over, and it's about as far as you and I are from each other, and he said, get in. And I looked at this, and I thought, you know, and at that point, I think it might have been later in 47, if not 40, it must have been 47, because I remember I rode my bike down, and it was probably a mile and a half. And so he hesitated, and he said, no, get in. I didn't know how in the world you get in. There's no door. And he said, just stand still. And he reached over, and he said, just put your arms out. He put his arms around me, and picked me up and walked over. And I probably weighed about maybe 80 pounds, and I was small. And he picked me up and he said, hold your legs out straight. And so I did. And he said, okay, now put them in. And he slid me down and he reached over and he put the seatbelt on. And there were no harnesses back in those days. And so, believe it or not, this all has to do with landscape architecture. But you see, if I get an audience like that and people are not fidgeting, then I think maybe there's something here, but it all connects. And there's a part of this, which even interrupting now, I've always had curiosities about things, and the curiosities probably originated from that period that I was telling you about, 1944, that I was by myself, because I always had to kind of make my own interest areas. I read history. My dad had been a history teacher. He had his degree in history. So all of a sudden, during that time that I was there, fiction no longer became very interesting to me. It was the history. And my dad had a good background. Okay, so we're now back to the race car, and the guy's got me in the car. So all of a sudden, there's 12-year-old Mike Parker, and it's like, now it's the main event. And I'm, all this stuff's going through my eyes. And I'm sitting there, and I'm imagining that the loudspeaker saying, on the pole position tonight, for the A-Main event, fast time of the night, winner of the trophy dash, Mike Parker, you know, everybody's applauding. But you see, this is this thing about imagination. And so, believe it or not, it has an effect with landscape architecture. And I can explain what it was. So I started going to races when I was, I'd go out and catch the bus, or my folks would drop me off, and I'd get back. The one thing that I hadn't expected, and this was when I was in high school, was on those older tracks. They were extremely dangerous. So as a teenager in high school, probably at 14 or 15, people go out, they get excited, and if there's a crash, you do that. But what happened was is that I saw some fatalities. And all of a sudden, this was no longer a friendly game. It was lethal. So I thought, I didn't want to see, I mean, you'd see cars hitting each other and the rest of it. But there was that overriding thing, is that this is extremely dangerous, and there is a possibility that people can get killed. So I started working at the Troutdale Airport between my junior and senior year, so I was around airplanes. Before that, I worked in a drugstore, down in the basement, actually making up all kinds of liquids and things, and I was 15 then, which Jeff Chabot says, you couldn't do that. I said, but I was doing it. And so I would ask him about things, and he'd say, well, you'll have to have a prescription for that. And I'd say, I know it was alcohol and salicylic acid, but I can't remember the rest of it. And so what they used to sell at Central Drug in Portland for a dollar, Jeff Chabot winds up getting this. I get the prescription, and he makes a concoction, and it costs me $25 for a bottle that's half the size of what I was making before. Anyhow, I wanted to get out of the basement of the drugstore. I wanted to work at the airport, at an airport, and I found out that there was a fellow that was a partner out at Troutdale at Skyways that belonged to the Presbyterian Church that my family attended. So they said, talk to Vern Hickman, and so I talked to him and he hired me, so now I had a job at an airport. And that was really an exposure because there were maybe a total of five mechanics. I worked in the engine shop, cleaning up things, tearing stuff down. And then I worked in the hangar, so I was as a mechanics helper. But I was starting to learn some basic skills about it. So my senior year, I worked out at the Portland Airport. The manager, Vern Hickman, and another fellow formed a partnership to bring Drummond Widgets, which were an amphibian, with the Ranger 175s, I think they were, to a six-cylinder Lycoming engine that was a new aircraft engine. The performance was just drastically better. That started to give me more experience around airplanes. The next year, now we're up to 1953, I graduated from high school and I worked at Skyways, or Flightcraft in Portland. They were a beach dealer, but also had mechanics and had fuel around bigger airplanes, around more people that were flying. But here comes the trick. I found out if I worked there, an employee could learn to fly, instructor, airplane, and fuel for $4 an hour. I mean, this is 1953, but it was still pretty inexpensive, and I was making, I think, maybe $1.25 an hour. So I started flying, and as you know, and as you already know now, I'll talk about it. Hamlin was the instructor, and he was the manager. So we take off together one day, and we go, and Al's talking to me, and I'm taking off with my 2-0 day with the Southwest, and all of a sudden, Al had been an Air Corps instructor during World War II, and he slammed the throttle back, and pulled the throttle back, put his hand in, and of course I immediately start trying to shove it. And I'm not going to repeat the profanity, but what it was is that he had distracted me. And I didn't have, I mean, I was still at a safe altitude, but it wasn't what I should have been. And I'm still taking off and trying to get altitude. And I'm trying to do it. And that was about 45, I think, at the time. And, you know, so there I am, 17. What in the world am I going to do about this? And it frightened me. Finally, he took his hand out and said, okay, don't, when you take off, he said, don't ever be distracted. And there were other little things I picked up from him. So I'm 17 years old at that point. So I started Reagan State in 1953. They start talking about the new Air Force Academy being built in Colorado. And I take exams for that. And then in August of 54, I get a phone call from the Oregonian. They said, could you come down tomorrow? And this is Saturday evening. My folks were at their house at Seaview. I get this call about 7 o'clock or 7:30 on a Saturday night. They said, could you come to the Oregonian tomorrow morning and have your picture taken? And I said, yeah. And then I said, what, why are you going to take my picture? And he said, well, you're one of Homer Angel's. Homer Angel was a representative of Congress. You're one of his nominations for the Air Force Academy. And I'm going, holy mackerel. So I go down and I, you know, now you've got the part about the flying. Now it's kind of coming in. And I go down and I take more, I get my picture taken, and then the things start coming for physicals and more, and I can't remember if there were more written exams at that point, but I keep moving on. And then I go up to McCord, another physical, this is in, on late 54, they dilate my eyes and I get rejected. And I have 20/20 vision, I don't understand that part. Well, it's before a computer, so I jump into applying to the Air Force to get through on their, to go on their flight cadet program. Everything goes fine on the writtens, everything goes fine on the exam, and I'm back up at McCord again, and they dilate my eyes, bingo. So at that point, I'm really disappointed. All I wanted to do at that point, and I'm still a freshman or a sophomore in Oregon State, I just want to fly airplanes and drive race cars. And these aren't the kind of things that parents get really involved in. But then the curiosity starts to work on it. So I let this sort of go for a while about that. And then I transferred down to the University of Oregon. And I go down there, and Dick Tully, who's a friend from Oregon State, I took the written exams for the Navy's program. This was after I transferred. I still don't have airplanes out of my mind. So I took the writtens for the NAVCAP program. Here we go up to Sandpoint Naval Air Station. Take more writtens of physical, and I'm good. I dilate my eyes. The corpsman says, "You're right on the line. I don't want to make the call. Get the doctor in." The doctor comes in, and there was a Marine captain who was a pilot. His last name was Parker, so we kind of formed a thing that wasn't our last name, the medic and the doctor. So I'm sitting on a stool, and the doctor's sitting in a chair, and I've got Captain Parker, and I've got the corpsman. So I've got the three of them, and the doctor says to me, he said, "You're right on the line." He said, "I can pass you in good conscience. You're not a hazard to yourself or anyone else. But I have to warn you, if you go to Pensacola and they dilate your eyes," the other doctor may interpret it differently, and he said, "and if you're rejected there, you're going to spend 2 years as a white hat with the fleet." Well, I didn't want to wear a sailor hat and wear a sailor suit and be on the ship, so I canceled on that. So at that point, flying is totally out of my mind. 1958, so we're talking another 3 years, I'm working at the airport in Portland again. They have the dedication of the new terminal, and I'm working for flight craft, and I take people in this Volkswagen bus across to have my clean ones and coveralls on. And at the end of the afternoon, I wanted to see the planes that were on display, and so I parked the bus, and I got out, and I walked down, and I wanted to see all these fighters, because I wanted them to fly fighters, and it's all over for me. And I walked down, and I see a group of people gathered around up ahead, and I walk, and then I get up there, and I look. The pilot sitting on the wing is Dick Tully, the one I'd gone up to Sandpoint Naval Air Station on December 27th of 1955. Now we're up to 1950. And I saw him sitting there, and there's a pretty young woman sitting on the wing beside me being interviewed. And I just took one look at that, and I said, "Airplanes don't like me. I don't like airplanes." And I just turned around, and that was the end of the flying. So, almost. I went through the University of Oregon. I concentrated on that. Graduated in 1960. I don't regard myself as particularly a good student from the standpoint of making grades, but yet when I graduated, and I had a conflict with the department chairman, for 4 out of the 5 years I was down there. And I look back at, because of the way that I was treated, I didn't see things the way that he saw them, but I had the encouragement of other profs. So kind of out of my own salvation, I had to defend myself. And in retrospect, I've always said, a person in a teaching situation has absolutely no right to treat a student like that. Now, why that ever occurred, I don't know. But it happened. When I graduated, and they have a kind of a ceremony at the end giving award. Here's the department chairman, and I get the award for the outstanding student. Along with that came a scholarship, not a full scholarship, but a scholarship to the graduate school at Harvard. And I was angry about it. Why did I have to put up with 4 years of this? But actually, when you look at it and seeing what that did in terms of what my attitude towards other things were, it was probably a pretty good training ground. The other thing that came out of that experience was that I've had younger people. I didn't raise kids, didn't have kids, had not been married for long periods of time. But the younger kids were always important to me because I had so many mentors. Ah, one other thing. So before I graduated, now we're up to October 1959, I decided to stay out of school that fall term because I knew what I was going to confront with the department chair. So if I could pick up a job working with some architects, doing residential landscape design or two, that would get me up to January. I go back to school. October, I stop off at this office, and there's five, I say, younger architects. They were World War II vets, and three of them were getting a lot of recognition. So I leave my portfolio with Don Blair, who I had met one time before, and I'll come back and pick it up the next day. So at that point, I just turned 24. And so I come back the next day, to get my portfolio, and Don said, you know, we got together, we talked about you, and what we think is you ought to open a practice. And I'm thinking, you know, I haven't even graduated from school yet. So, but all of this is kind of the training ground for what came later.
Michael, what was in your portfolio?
Pardon?
What was in your portfolio?
Oh, landscape, there would be student work, landscape design, planning, projects, the basic kind of things that you take and show landscape architects affirm what it is that what your basic drafting skills are.
So you were in landscape school.
Yeah.
I missed that.
Okay.
Didn't see me.
I will speak well.
Well, I
no, that's okay. But what happened was that these three people, Don Blair, Saul Zay, Bill Fletcher, Alex Pierce, they were getting all kinds of attention in the local newspapers and with the emphasis on design. And all of a sudden, here's Mike Parker, and he has a practice of his own. But what they said was, he could go up there with Latchy's got space up in his. Now, this was an old wood frame house on 14th and Plumber, which the freeway's taken out. So I go up, and there is a space. My drafting board, I always remember, was 32 inches wide, and it was 52 inches wide and about 30 inches wide. So they could go up against this wall. There was a window here, and there was this much room between the drafting board and the stool and the back wall. This was my office for free. And so I was in fog heaven. Now, I wind up doing the job for one of the architects, and it was a master plan for a church camp, and I think it was for a Methodist church. And and I always remember that I think my total fee for that, of course, I was just absolutely elated. It was either $147 or $247, and I'm thinking that it may have been at the high end that it was $247. So, and I was absolutely elated that I now had a project. Okay, comes January, back to school. One of the profs had a practice in Eugene named Lloyd Bonnet. And I go back and I see him before classes have started. He said, oh, I heard you're coming back this term. You're coming back as a student or in a professional capacity. And I thought, that was not a good introduction. And so I go back and I go through. We have a thesis project, a project, which back in those days, and this is kind of outdated, but it was an estate. We had to design a house and all these grounds. But it was the mechanics of doing it. So I come up for my final review, and there'd be a group of people just like you are, and I've got the drawings that are on the wall, and I go through and I describe it, and then comes the time where you all leave, and it's just the faculty members. So there was Cuthbert, Lloyd Bond, George Jetty. Ah, that's another one, too. I'll tell you about that in a minute, because there's significance there. And Lloyd Bond. So I have five people in there. And I was defensive because I didn't know what was going to happen. And so I start in and they're asking me questions about the project and I realize they're sharpshooting it. And I was defensive about it because I knew that I was going to get worked over. And finally, he got to a point, Fred Cuthbert, the chairman, said, well, I thought when you came back to school, you were going to be in a position where I could start teaching you again. Wrong thing to say to me. I said, hell, I've been here for 5 years and I cannot think of a single thing that I learned from you. I know where I'm going and what I'm going to be doing. And he said, with your attitude, I don't know whether I'm going to award you a degree or not. And I said, then why don't you just keep the degree? I mean, I was not happy. Now, George Jenny, who I just mentioned, George is very glad he doesn't upset anybody. And all of a sudden, George steps in and says, because now Cuthbert and I are going back and forth. The other faculty members that are there don't want to get in it. And George steps in and he said, all right, both of you, be quiet. And the next thing, Cuthbert is at me again. Fred, shut up. And, I mean, the shock is that I'm listening to George Jenny. So, he said, all right, tell Mike what he needs to do to make changes so that he can graduate. So blah, 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 blah. And so I wind up taking my drawings and I make modifications and I go down, put them in George's office, roll them up, and I thank him for the 5 years that I've been there. I started doing lectures, guest lectures at the University of Oregon, and then I did up at Pullman and other places. So this is part of this thing of going back to all of the mentors that I had, and I had, I mean, a ton of them. I'm still not going racing, though. And so what happened was is that in my own self-training, I was telling you about the curiosities. If you're not racing, where are you going to learn to drive fast when you look for the roads between Corvallis and Eugene, and you drive much faster than you should, and you go to the right state and you come down to Highway 99 and you do that for several years. The interesting part of it is that if you put it in your mind, I'm learning how to do this safely, because remember I told you about the fatalities? I can't do these things and create an accident where I'm going to get hurt or anybody else is going to get hurt. Okay, so we got that part of it, the student. But with this all still carries into the landscape architecture, that it had to do with the organization of land, not landscaping. It starts off, and you pretty much have that, when you start getting into park design, you get into schools, recreation, riverfront projects, and then you may start getting into housing projects, condominium projects, apartment projects, things that are useful, but maybe not as interesting as I might think, because I've done so many of them. But I'll give you an example of one that was a surprise to me. Back behind Salishan at the lodge down on the coast, which had a lot of recognition, John Gray, who was the owner and developer, and he had been the principal, or been the, he was the principal stockholder for Walmart Industries in Portland, and they saw chain and the rest of that, and bars. And he was the one that had developed Salishan. And so I'd done work for Walmart on an industrial park back in 1964. The first large project, this one also won some national awards, but I was, you know, an unknown at that point. But I was 28 then. And that background of the history was kind of the origins of where an industrial park came. And I'm out there kind of in Neverland by myself. The project was completed on schedule, and there was innovation to it, and it received some national awards. I was elated. I didn't shoot for awards. That never was it. It's how good a job can I do? So I was driven by that part. John Gray developed additional housing back behind a subdivision, big subdivision behind the lodge. And he wanted me to come down and look at it. They cut the roads through, and trees had been taken down. Not a lot of them. And the project manager was there. And so John and Bill Schwartz and I were walking around, and John said, what do you think we should do? And so this was kind of, this is not a highly refined sort of project, but it's still part of this coastal environment. And I went through there, and I looked at it, and I said, why don't you just leave it alone? Now, the project manager wasn't real happy with that remark. I said, no, pull out all the stumps and the trees, clean up the site, and then just leave it alone. All this growth is going to come back, and it's going to come back very quickly. I'd never seen this until probably a dozen years ago. I went down for another reason. I stayed at the project manager's house, and I got to tell you, I could not figure out or see where any other houses were, and yet it was extremely dense, it was very dense. And I thought, you know, here's an example of just leave it alone, let nature take its course, and it's going to be just fine. And they had a design, a pretty rigid design review process, design standards for housing and whatever you were doing with landscaping. And I remember walking around there and looking, and I said, you know, people have maybe planted some flowers along borders and things, but this is all either the material that was in here that was cut back, grew back up, or else they supplemented it with more of the same material. So here's the logic then that worked for me, that started to develop some things on that. We go back to the racing part of it, because this starts to enter into it too. 1963, in Car and Driver magazine, there's a story about John Hoogenholtz, who had just designed a major racing circuit for Honda in Japan, called the Suzuka circuit. And but what was impressive about this story about John Hoogenholtz, and he managed the circuit at Zandvoort, and was the safety in the design for this road racing circuit. Which road racing circuits are irregular, and it's an abstraction of the road. There's straightaways, there's turns, there's changes in elevation. But I was talking about the safety factor. And when I saw that, now we're going back to Mike Parker being in high school and seeing those fatalities. So at that point, I now have this background as a landscape architect. I'm 3 years out of college. But all of a sudden, here is a need, because in the 1950s and 1960s, there was an incredible number of racing facilities on road racing circuits in the United States and overseas. I write letters. So I write John Hoogenholtz a letter, and I tell him kind of what my background is, and I get a letter back from him, and he's interested. And then coincidentally, he's going to be in Eugene, Oregon, that a group of businessmen down there have hired him to develop a racing circuit south of Eugene. This goes back to that expect the unexpected. Here's this thing, here's, you know, essentially a teenager still thinking, can something be done about that? So what happened was is that I go down and I did a hypothetical. I'm a cheater at times, but this was positive because we're looking at it and saying, if I can participate, I can help make this safer. So I do a hypothetical racing circuit based on the article that I've read. Yeah, I'm telling you guys my secret. That's one of the biggest secrets I've had all my life. And you know it, so don't tell anybody else about it. But what happened was is that I went down and I had two drawings. One of them was a plan and another was a topography. And I explained to the gentleman about the racing circuit. One of the other people that was there, that was part of this business group, they were really concerned because this one was supposedly west of Portland out in the Beaverton area. I said they had They had an option, they didn't develop it, nothing's going to happen. So the ones at Eugene go, so that's good because there's no competition. Hoogenholtz and I spent, I took a drafting board and some things down. I said, if you like, I'll stay and I can revise drawings for you, meet your draftsman, it's great. So we spent 2 or 3 days and he said, I've got inquiries from others in the US, and he said, would you like to work with me? Well, what I like to work with. So we started an association in 1968 that I would work on US facilities. He would come over if that was possible with clients. I went to Europe in 1965. I was over there in May, and April and May, and traveled around Europe, saw all of the major racing circuits. So I had that kind of inventory of the history and what these were. John had told me there's absolutely nothing about any racing circuits in Europe that you want to duplicate for an American circuit. Okay, so we're in the 1960s. Now, racing in the US was becoming really a big thing in the 1960s. I mean, we had the Indy cars, you had drag racing, we had road racing, you had a whole lot of professional series. So, I had bought a Sprite, an Austin Healey Sprite that had been a race car. And I raced that in 65 over the 4th of July weekend. I'm heading down a straight, and a guy that's in second, I'm moving in front, he moves over and taps my rear. The car spins around, goes up a bank on the right, and the next thing I know is the car is going in for that, and I'm hanging on. I mean, I'm really hanging on. And so I went about 200 feet at the maximum speed of that car, which probably couldn't have been much over 110 or 115, but, well, I'll tell you, when you're riding in that thing, and you go, bam, bam, and then it'd be quiet, because it was up in the air. So, when it came to rest, the other car was on its side, the guy was out, and he was laying down. I got out, and I could do this, and there's no blood or anything, I'm moving around. The car had collapsed from the left front, right up to the driver's compartment, the right rear, and I walked away from it. But, this is that expect the unexpected. And I said, if we don't do something about this race track out at Delta Park, we're gonna have more fatalities. So, in July of 65, I took it upon myself that I gotta get to the racetrack. I get a call in December of 65, and the fellow said, this is Paul Faberman. I'm with Stoldy Incorporated. I understand you know, have some experience with racing circuits. I don't know who Stoldy is, and I had to ask him. It turned out they were big developers out of Oakland. They built hospitals and other things. And so they wanted to know, could I come down? So I went down early July, and it turns out this is a huge facility that they want to build, but they don't have anybody that knows how to design the road courses. So I spent a day with them, and at the end of the day, Bill Lewis, who was the president of Stoldy, said, just to be honest with you, he said, you mentioned names of architecture firms, and he said, we've done work with Stimwings and Merrill's office in San Francisco, and they had a parking office. And he said, we talked to John Merrill in San Francisco, and he called the partner in Portland. He said, we've got an excellent reputation. And he said, we'd like to have him involved in the project for as long as it's alive. So I spent about 6 months designing it and going back and forth over a period of back and forth about once a week for the next 6 months. And we got it done, and then it was finally constructed in 1970, completed in 70. They had a race. I went down there for that race. And I went down as a spectator, and Brock Yates, who I knew was the editor, car and driver, was, and I had become acquainted. And the next day, I'd been invited to go to the banquet. I didn't want to go to the banquet. I wanted to walk around. I wanted to spend time, because for me, it was a learning process. What happened was, at the banquet that night, Jackie Stewart, who was world champion, made the comment at the banquet. This, and Brock told me, so Jackie Stewart said, this is the safest racing circuit in the world. So, you know, here it is. Go back to that time that you're 12 years old, or it starts off down at Blackwood's getting into the midget, and it continues on down. So I knew at that point that the skills were there, but John Hugenholz is the one that was the mentor on that. And so that was built. Then 1970, I finally got the money, and we designed Portland International Raceway. A lot of friendships that had come out of that, and it was home. So I donated all that time between 1965 and 1971, and it was expensive. They got it through in time. It was completed in time for the Rose Cup races. And John Bradshaw, who was the chief steward, said just before they were opening it up on Sunday morning, he said, you want to ride with me? And just driving around, and I gotta tell you, I looked, and the corner Martians were out, and they were waving, and the next thing I knew is the tears started coming. And it was all predicated that we can't kill people. Later, Emerson Fittipaldi, who had also been Formula One champion, when they were running the kart series, and he was driving for Penske, he'd been Formula One champion, won in Indianapolis, he went to see Dale LaFlawitt, who was the manager, and he said, I just wanted to tell you how much we appreciate coming to PIR. It's a safe facility, and it's easy on equipment, you know. So there was the confirmation. So now we're out of that. Next thing you know is, we get up to about 1972, and I'd been kind of the president of the local group as part of the national sanctioning organization, Sports Car Club of America, but I was also on the national planning committee. Okay, long range, looking at things, it came straight out of landscape architecture and planning. The process is the same, even if it doesn't have anything to do with the physical planning. So I did that, and then there I am about 1970, you know, single. I missed the competition, I really did miss that, but what do I want to do? I don't want another car, I don't want all the logistics. 1970, my wife and I had been up at Kemp at Seattle International Raceway, and it was a national motorcycle road race 3 weeks after Daytona. And Roberta and I were watching, I could not believe what was happening, because I had raced cars up there, but I could not imagine what was happening with motorcycles, that many at those speeds going into this first turn. I mean, it was beyond comprehension. And they're all exposed, you have a fairing around it, but they're still exposed, so you have this real sense that it's a person there. Well, the next year, July 71, I go up to Kent again with a friend, and he and I watch and kind of go, oh, that's good, come back. Now, about curiosities and things like that, I did a little more cross racing. Terry Seifert's heard this story before, but it came July of 1972. I decided that I want to go motorcycle road racing. I get fitted for the leathers and I run, I get my weight down. I weigh about 160 pounds and I'm probably at, who knows where, 220 or something like that. But here comes the same thing again, that it's something that I really wanted to do. I go down, I buy a motorcycle from a biochemist that teaches up at OHSU, so Dr. Black has an older series motorcycle. So I wind up sending an order down to California, they do that, and I wind up having painting it and doing it. Now, we're up to July of 1972. You had to have a professional license to be able to run a national race. I'd never road raced a motorcycle before. But I had a national license for the sports cars and an international license. So I write the American Motorcycle Association. I put my check in there, explain what my experience is. And in the mail, I have now got the national number, which turned out to be 13, which I thought, don't be superstitious about that. International license. So the short part of this is I got ready to go out on that first practice session, and about from here to the end of that group over here. You're letting bikes out one at a time in about 1 second, and then it just hits me. You've never ridden one of these things before. You know, I mean, so this becomes this thing about expect the unexpected. But, I mean, this is an extremely high-risk activity. So I go out, you know, and here I am at 37, and the rest of them are like 17, 18, and an old one might be 24 years old and I'm 36 years old. But I don't want to look foolish. So I go out and I say, well, what you better do is kind of take it easy for the first few laps, Parker, and then you start cutting the fast laps afterwards. Well, about that time, the ones that went out for that practice session are coming around and laughing at me. I got to learn this track. I could not believe up that close how fast they were going. I mean, I had absolutely no concept that they could go. And they're from about the distance that Sheldon is for me. And I'm thinking, oh boy, I really stepped in it big time. Now, here comes the other part. The guy says, what heat race are you in? I said, what do you mean a heat race? He said, well, you know, what heat race? I said, I don't know, what about that? He said, well, you gotta run a 5-lap heat race, transfer into the main race. Oh, I mean, and this is really serious. This is how naive I was. Oh, I didn't know about that. So, at that point, you have about 30 bikes on the grid, and I think there were, for the whole race, there were like, as near as I could figure out from some photographs, there were about 120 entered. Out of that, they would take 60 on the starting grid for the race. The minute that flag came down, and you're waiting, and you're watching it, and your bike is out on the line, and you're waiting, and you push the start, and you come back, and you've got a spot in there, and somebody from your team, which I didn't have a team, but I knew somebody and they held their hand up and that's my starting spot, where I knew from the way it was on the grid. But you watch it up on the starter, a board, and the first board that comes out is 5. And you'll hear it, they'll say, the 5-minute board's out, 5 minutes, the race is going to start almost at 5 minutes. The 4 minute word comes out, then the 3 minute. You've got to be, so then you push and you start, you go down, you turn around, and you look, and there are all these people, and everybody has to wear white, it's on a crew, and you look, and in 3 minutes, that whole sea of white moves off to the side, and now all you got is this line of very rigid motorcycles. Well, here's Mike Clark at 36, pulling up into his starting spot, and this is not the same as a 17 or an 18 year old, and I'm thinking, holy mackerel. But the interesting part was, when that flag went down, I was gone. And it was a kicky, and I'd driven, I'd had a number of other race cars, single place open wheel race cars, but it was that immediate response that was the start, and it wasn't until just a few years ago that I remembered looking back and remembering what that experience was, and I don't remember very many other riders and bikes that were in front of me. I said, Parker, you were always a good starter with the cars, and that's why there weren't that many bikes in front of you. Well, anyway, I transferred into the main race, and I wrote a story at the end of the week, and it was just called Hole in the World. So here is all this life of the landscape architect and the proprieties and the rest of it. And I was chairman of the design commission, and here was all this other. But all of a sudden, there was another world out there. It didn't mean that it was going to be a motorcycle race. But I decided that next year, I'm going to have another bike. I'm going to run all the nationals, so the road races, there were 9 of them. And so what happened with that was I ran the Daytona race, and then 3 weeks later, back to 72, there was a race in Ontario, the track that I had designed. And so I ran that national, and then the next year, I was going to run all 9 of the nationals. The second one was in late March. And last practice session, and the night before, one of the mechanics had said, Don, because now I had a team in California maintaining my bike, I said, Don, it's got times on you and Murray. Murray was the 18-year-old that had finished third in a race at Daytona. And Don said, the mechanic said, Don's got times on you and Murray. You're quicker than Murray. So here I am now, 37, and I'm quicker in Texas. I think that I knew I was competitive. I guess that was it. So I thought, okay, last practice session, I get a brain failure and I crashed. And I remember putting me back in the ambulance. And then when I got to the aid station, they said, take him to Park. Basically, I'm in shock or trying to fight it, but I kept thinking Parkland, 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 Parkland. And then it hit me, that's where Kennedy had gone 10 years before he was shot in Dallas. And I started waking up and I said, you're going to see something out of history. We got there and the guys stood up and I said, and they started to get me out on the stretcher. I said, no, you stay there. Well, I was alert at that point. I said, you know, I want to. So I walk in, and I'm not comfortable at all. I broke a collarbone, I broke all my ribs on the left side, and I punctured the lung, so I was not comfortable. But I walked in and I was, to the best of my knowledge, alert. This is where they had taken Kennedy and I remembered all those TV things. Okay, so the next part of the story is that there's a club race. I'm entered for the race back in New Hampshire in early June, so I wind up, a friend loans me his bike. First practice session, first lap. It had rained the night before. Everything is dry except for a little moist patch through that first turn, and that went very fast. The bike goes down. I go over to pick it up. I can't pick it up. My arm hurts. So 3 days later, I go to see my orthopedic surgeon who has to sign the release because I'm fine on this side, and he thought there was no rush on it, and I go in, and Sam, his name is Sam Gill, we were personal friends. And I told him, I didn't know anything about that. I said, well, that's what I was trying to tell your daughter when I called. You have a young daughter. So he does it, and he picks it up, and I said, what do you think it is? You know, and he said, I think you've got a ruptured bicep. And I said, is that bad? He said, well, if you do surgery, you'll have you'll be able to use your right arm. I'm thinking, oh no, I mean, this is bad news. So he comes back with the x-rays, and he's got a big smile. He said, your bicep's okay, but I sure know why it hurts. So he puts the x-ray up, and I got a fracture right below the joint. So he said, now look, I don't think I can do any more racing this year. He said, personal friends. He said, I think maybe next year, if you want to do it, go ahead. Long story, but it's longer, but it all leads into things. So people say, are you racing? Are you still racing? I said, no, they took my toys away. Okay, expect the unexpected again. I find out about a competition at the Renwick Gallery at the Smithsonian called Craft Multiples. And I kind of fussed around with these wooden toys, but all of a sudden it's a competition again. And so I read this thing, it is a multiple. Or something can be made in multiples but not mass produced. So I second guess them and I go ahead and in about 11 days or 12 days I design this whole line of wooden toys, have them photographed, and I send it to the Smithsonian. And so all of a sudden I got focused on toys and I started making them, and then they started going to people and then competition comes in. So I sold to FAO Shores, Neiman Marcus, and a couple of others. So it meant that it was acceptable. So that was over with. And so I go back, I'm still a landscape architect, and then in October of 1981, in December of 81, we make the short list for the design of a new entrance for the Portland Airport. There was never a question about my ethics, but I would call people publicly at public meetings that were architects or landscape architects. And so I would alienate them, which didn't make any difference because my only interest was the public interest. I want to design this new entrance to the airport as does anybody else. It's got a substantial budget, it's high visibility. And make a long story short, we get selected for it. And it's about a $10 million project in 2016 dollars. Do that, and I started thinking this is a good project to end a practice. And so it came October 6th of 1980, the year before. I go up in that morning and I take that photograph. And I've been flying and I've been photographing, but I'm not good enough yet. I just keep doing it and doing it. We get the airport project, go through that, that takes it out to, well, construction in 82. And the more I'm thinking about it, maybe I'm going to close that practice. But, you know, this goes back to the masculine thing about men are identified by their vocation, usually a vocation, something that I look at. I've done all of these other activities and I like them, but what do I do if I'm not a landscape architect? So I closed the office at the end of 83. So as of 1984, January 1st of 84, I'm an aerial photographer, not a landscape architect. I have a plane, I bought a plane in a Cessna 150, two place, 100 mile an hour, simple. This was the other thing. It was simple and it meant that if I had to go someplace else, I could fly a commercial, rent a plane, and I had virtually the same, I had identically the same airplane that I used in Portland. So at that point, I am now a genuine in business aerial photographer. And I'm doing work for architects, engineers, planning firms, and some for public agencies. Now, and that was, this is the other part. Here comes this planning background that I've got from landscape architecture. You can put me in an airplane with a camera. And I can begin to put myself in the position that this is a project that I have to gain and have an understanding for. So I did all of the aerial photography for the final route negotiations for Portland's West Side Light Rail and then the expansion of that, which was not so much the photography that's important, but what's the information in those photographs. And so I do that, and then I'd sold my house in Portland in 86, in June of 86. We're getting close to the end of the story. And what am I going to do next? And I don't really know. I go to Seattle, I started looking for a place to live. I'm doing work for Seattle firms. And I come down, to the coast and I have my house on the weekends. And I started doing that all the time in 86. I kept my bridge receipts from 85, I think it was, or 84. And it turned out, even though I lived and worked in Portland full time, I spent 125 nights at Oysterville. And that was another one of these expect the unexpected. I had no idea it was that much. So I came down I was coming down in the fall, but I came down in November. And when I came down in November, the meadow across the road was filled full of surveyor stakes. And I thought, wait a minute, what is this? Because I knew that in the first place it was a wetland. You can't subdivide because it floods in the wintertime. The water would be 3 feet deep out there and you can't fill it. And there's no way of disposing of for sewage disposal. So all of a sudden there's a problem. I don't know what to do. So I called Lee Weider, and I told Lee, and he hadn't known anything about it. I had absolutely no awareness of what was going on here other than the design and dealt with Ken Kimura, who was then the planning director. And I'd come out of, Portland where, and things in the state where you have competent people who are doing things. So it comes November 20th of 1986, which I always refer to as the most expensive day of my life. There's one person that's present here that knows what that is, because that was the evening that I met Dick Sheldon. And so what happened was, Dick walked up and he said, Lee called me and he said, the Espies are trying to make a run at the subdividing the meadow. I didn't know anything about any of this except I knew that it obviously is not something that's legal. But all my experience was in urban situations, mostly in urban situations, and that didn't really was not applicable. Some of the basics were there, but I didn't have a background in environmental issues. So we did that, got involved with that, and then I went up to Seattle on the 29th of December in 86. I shot two projects up there for a Seattle firm, and on the drive back I said, just swallow it and make the move, and because you can do something useful here. And that's what it was. That's the other part of it too that I always have to kind of bring up is that none of the things that I've done have been motivated by fees. You know you have to generate income, but a lot of this came from the early ethics that we had growing up, and since most of us are above 70, that was just hammered into us about doing what's right and the ethics. And so that was what happened here. Now, I'm an aerial photographer. And the whole city county is big. I can photograph and do all these things, which I did do. I wound up with about, I think there were about 20 or 30,000 photographs of the bay. And what I wanted to do was to document this so that later on, people that could use this information, if we have a major event, that say, what in the world was this guy doing photographing this whole county? And so I did that. And then we're getting close to the end. Actually, not too bad on my time. I actually put up, it's interesting, I have to tell you my secret science. I knew that I wasn't going to have 12 and 13, 14 year olds. And so I started taking notes of subjects, and then I went to print them. I was going to put them into that computer and print them in the printer goes chronology at the end. So I probably have covered most of those things. But what I was doing at the same time, and I'm going to move into the photography because kind of end the part with the environmental issues. I got involved with those. I was on what they call the Dunes Management Committee, which was to make recommendations what to do with the 28 miles of beach run. So that got into the issue of setbacks and erosion and the rest of it. I won't get into that, but it was critical and it was important. At the same time, I was photographing, from the air. And I'm going to just do one little simple thing here. You can probably all see, I should have had it. People say, how do you fly an airplane and take pictures? And I say, it's very simple. And everything that I've talked about, what I did, is simple. And it is. So, I would be sitting in the left seat. The throttle's here. There's a window. It's got stops on it, which I removed so that I can open this up and slide it, ease it up, and the air pressure will keep that window up at the bottom. There's no other modification to the airplane. That's it. I went through a phase where I was trying to find out about mounts, and I can do this remotely, and it, you know, and you have a screen and a gimbal here, and it moves the camera, the cameras that are mounted out on a gimbal. And it's too complicated. And so now, here's the throttle. I got my feet on the rudder pedals, and I got a hand free. I can turn the wheel on it and move that. Back in 1953, down at Aurora, which is just a state-owned strip, I see a plane down there, and I land. And there's two men there, and they're flying a lesson. And I look, and one of the guys, as it turned out, was the pilot. And he only had one arm. And I don't remember whether it was the right arm or the left arm, but I always remember he's flying that airplane with just one hand, one arm. And he set something up over here. I said, I've got two hands. So I can begin to work. And I finally concluded the simplest thing and the most sophisticated mount for those cameras is your hand. It'll move in any direction, up or down, and it's immediately connected to your brain. But it was very awkward for me at the beginning, and it was so awkward that at some time I thought, God, I don't know whether I can get this, because I have to do it safely. So I would keep going out practicing, and I'd go to the farmland, and I'd go out to the farmland because I don't have other air traffic out there, and I would practice. Well, I knew how to do the photography to document it. But what can be the creative photography? So these two are from the Bay. This is over in Eastern Washington. When I would go, and people would ask me that, and don't let me forget to give you your 22nd photography lesson. I haven't taken any classes in photography, so people can ask technical questions, and I can maybe give a roundabout answer, but also I have to learn the darkroom skills. So everything that you see is done by somebody who's essentially ignorant of very much of the technology. But I also had other people that would kind of coach me. I used a rental darkroom in Portland, and that was, and so I would make trips when I was doing a lot of photography in Portland every week or 10 days. So I'm now in a group of people that are all photographers, and if you're in the darkroom, they say, what'd you do here? And you tell them, you say, why don't you try this? So they weren't classes, but you had the experience of other people. Now, Robert Adams, that had written the foreword to the book here, has an international reputation. He's in probably 100 museums around the world. He had a MacArthur Foundation grant, and it's in the Museum of Modern Art, New York, San Francisco, a real heavyweight. Go back to the letters again. Remember talking about all the letters? There's a story about him in the Oregonian. He was here. Randy Gregg was the arts and architecture writer for the Oregonian. And I called Randy, and I said, do you have Robert Adams' address? And he said, because I knew he was from Colorado, he said, he's here. They're staying with his parents at Astoria. I go, holy mackerel. So I write him a letter. And I get a call from him. He said, we're on our way back to Colorado. And he said, let me give you my address there. So that starts a correspondence. But we don't talk much about photography. We don't talk much about photography. We talk about kind of surrounding areas on it. But one of the things that Bob told me one time was, and this is the kind of thing that I can tell you. He said, you know, Mike, as you know, most good photographers are either self-taught or they learn from another photographer. But here are all these photography classes. You can pick things up technically, but you can't teach creativity. That's an entirely different thing. So that's a part of that. And another time, I'd given a lecture at Reed College, and there were students, and in the discussion afterwards, he made the remark to me that he said, you know, Mike, I just wanted to tell those kids, look, I see something, I have a camera, I take a picture, it's that simple. So, your first lesson, the 22nd lesson, or the 22nd lesson, hasn't yet occurred, and I'll show you exactly what it is, because somebody will say, how do you take these pictures, you know? Okay, we went through the area of photography. I took a lot of things. Some of it had to do with enforcement. I did enforcement work for State of Oregon, which I would be doing other work for them, and they would say, why don't you go up this river, go up there 5 miles and see if you can see any kind of construction along the shoreline. These would be remote areas. And sometimes they'd say, go back over, there's going to be an area in there, go back and see if you see any excavations. You know, here I am coming out of that other background. I mean, it's like a treasure hunt. But the all-time best one was clear over in Eastern Oregon. A farmer had a landing strip, and apparently what had happened was he had to extend the end of his landing strip. There was a river that came down like this, and he just started moving material around, and he diverted the direction of the river. And it wasn't big, but it had taken quite a lot of effort. So there I am, and I find this out in a remote place, and I look at it and I think, holy mackerel, nobody would ever know about this. I didn't even know how they knew about it. So I start, this is the other thing too. How do you know about these things or what they do? You'd circle them up at an altitude that you can see pretty much what you need to see, and then you start to focus in on the things that are pertinent to it. So I photograph this and I do it, and now I'm curious about his hangar and the other things, because he's got some other buildings along there. I go down, and the guy's out there, and I go by, he waves to me, and I wave to him. I go back around. He doesn't know what I'm doing. But what happened was is that they wound up sending him a letter with a fine and the photographs. Nothing ever happened. I mean, when I say nothing happened. And I found out, and the state of Oregon was doing this, and it was a simple, inexpensive way for them to get enforcement. And the big part of it is that you discourage other people from doing the same thing. Okay, so now I'm here at Oysterville, and there's things going on around here. I photograph them, and I become acquainted with people at the Department of Ecology because of what we were doing in the meadow at Oysterville, although that was resolved. And I send these to the fellow that I know at the Department of Ecology, and then I follow up and say, what'd you do with them? And he said, well, you know, just kind of, nothing really is what happened. And I should say, well, how many violations or reports of violations do you have in a month? And he said, 60 or 70. I said, how many citations do you issue? And he said, 2, maybe 3. So, you know, what happened was is that it's a confirmation the state of Washington had absolutely no enforcement of existing regulations, not asking for more. So I had good rapport with him. I said, why is this that you don't, why is it that you don't follow up with citing them? And he said, well, Mike, we don't want the legislature to think we're bounty hunters, you know, and you're paying for all of this. So that's my political message. But now, I had so much fun doing these things, but then comes the other part, and this is the tail end of the story. I don't have any idea about the black and white photography. I don't have anything about, I don't understand, I see it, and there's kind of a response, and I said, well, Parker, you're gonna have to start learning about this. So going back to that background in architecture and landscape architecture, you have to have an understanding of the history of photographer, history of landscape architecture and architecture, if you're going to be involved with these things. And the reason for it is, if you are here and there is a historical path that's followed, you need to know what happened here, 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 here. And it takes a lot of study. And now we're up to me. What do I do now? But you see, you have the experience of how that's progressed through history, and you have the experience of all of those people were involved. And it's like if we had something that we were trying to resolve here, we could all get together and just, and discuss it, and come to what we think of as a conclusion to it. But, so what I did, as I say, I don't know anything about black and white. I started in about 1990, saying, I have to start at the beginning. I started using old cameras, old folding cameras and others. I didn't want to be affected by any of the kind of current technology, although I had all those cameras to use in the air, for the aerial photography. The simple part of this was, I used simple cameras, one fixed lens on it, but the optics were good. So, and a tripod, that's another thing. So I was using medium format, which is 120 roll film. 35 millimeter would have worked probably just as well because the camera's being tripod. And I said, well, you need a final exam, so what are you going to do? And I said, well, I live in Oysterville. Why don't you just take your camera and walk around outside? So I started in October of 1995. And one camera, I did buy a new camera. The optics were better, but there were no other lenses other than one attached to the camera, but the optics were superb. And I just walked around Oysterville with my camera, looked around, and looked through the window, looked through the air. But see, I didn't have anybody with me to say, come on, I mean, let's go, what are you going to do? I did this for 2 years, between October of 95 and December of 96. I was going into Portland and making prints in the darkroom. But then comes this other question. What in the world are you going to do with 1,800 photographs of Oysterville? So, I don't think that I had an intent to, I didn't have an intent to do a book, but I think as I got further along with it, I said, you know, there's enough photographs to select from. Now comes the other nightmare, and that's how do you select? What about the editing? And so, fortunately, and we go back and I'm talking about mentors, I had a good friend, Bob Reynolds, that had been a photographer and he was a graphic artist and designed a lot of books for the Graphic Arts Center in Portland. And when I got interested in, and he taught at the Museum Art School in Portland in the 60s and the 70s, and we'd been friends. When I got started with the aerial photography, Bob was about a dozen years older, but he really gave me a lot of attention. And I was serious, I was dead serious. I'd go out, I'd photograph, and most of it was 35 millimeter and it was slides, so it was in color. And that was kind of where all of this indelible part came, because this all came before the black and white. And one day I was in his studio and we put some things on the light table and he's looking at it and he said, well, he had told me before, you know, you go in and people have a bazillion photographs and then you go through it. And he said, no, he said, you pick six the next time. So when you come in, you pick the six that you think are the best and we'll look at them, we'll keep discipline again. So I went in and we put six of them out there. I thought those were maybe the best ones. I took the others and they were in slide sleeves. He said, how long did it take you to make these pictures? And I said, I don't know, maybe. You know, and I was looking because I thought, you know, what's the magic answer? I said, you know, maybe 45 minutes, an hour. He said, what? He said, you did these in 45 minutes or an hour? And I said, well, yeah. See, this is how naive, but this is this other thing about not going into something new thinking that you've got all the answers on it. So that started me with this, with learning about the editing. And so if you're doing them in a block of things, and there's been exhibitions, but the, she's going
to
tell
me. I'm going to have to say.
I know, I'm right here, so you sit back and I'll call you on board. So what happened, and I haven't kept you a lot longer, but I'm going to tell you that I'm not going to apologize for it because maybe possibly something that I've said is something you're going to share with another person or a kid. Because that is the other part. I've also, let me get back to it. I was interrupted, you know. Diana, just sit tight. And I actually, you know, okay, last part of it. I actually put the stopwatch in my pocket, but then when I started talking to you before, I said, no, they just keep going, look at it, and if they start really fidgeting, then wrap it up. So you're a very kind audience. But what happened was that there was a book project that came out of it, and it was the editing and making choices on it. Then came the other part. This is pretty much the last part. There's two really very short ones at the end. I found out that there was a photography class at the middle school. And so I taught the middle school photography class in most of 2011 and 15. And I got to tell you, being around 12, 13, and 14-year-old kids was just an incredible experience. But here comes the other thing. Kids at those ages don't have any preconceived ideas about creativity or photography. But they've got, it's in their, the creative skills are in their head. How do you get it out? Going back to Cuthbert, the guy that's really attacking me, that's the chairman of the landscape department, architecture department, the University of Oregon. Also a role model that I don't in any way want to imitate. So, I mean, I look forward every Friday morning. That's great, you know, go and get, there's these kids, some of them, they would all, not all of them, some of them would surprise me. And I had one kid, we were outside, and we're talking about shadows. And I never tell people how to take pictures. I just talk, you know, it's like, what are you doing now? Look around. How many pictures do we have just in this space alone? That's part of your lesson here, and it's going to take you a second when we get to that. But the last Friday of May, they had a class, the photography class, but it was like the last Friday of the month, those 3 months. And there were two 90-minute sessions. One kid, it's at the end, the last class, and I don't remember his name, but I'd ask him before, he's quiet, doesn't say much. And there's 20 minutes to go, and I'm looking at my watch, and I said, I think maybe his name was John. I said, John, you have some pictures? And he said, yeah. But he's quiet. And I said, well, will you show me? And he had an iPad or something. Oh, that's the other thing. It makes no difference whether it's a camera or whatever it is. It's the visual part. And he shows me. And he said nothing in the class, never did it. That last 20 minutes, I saw the most interesting things that I had seen the whole previous class. And all I'm doing is saying, there's 20 minutes left. What do I do to kill the time? And if I hadn't, so what it did do is the impact on me, which again, expect the unexpected, as I said, whenever I'm in a group of kids, there's absolute brilliance here, but Parker, that's your treasure hunt. You got to go find out where it is and encourage you. Okay, now, you've all got iPads, you got, are you still okay? I just don't want to get nervous. Now, this part of it is serious, and this is how I'd start the kids off. If you're giving me your attention, which you are, you're looking at me, and maybe a bit of the surrounding. And when you go outside, or you can do it in here, but I always did it in the classroom, take your hands, cup them like this, so that you can do it, and put it up to your eye. And just slowly go around the room and down. You can isolate people. You can pick up part of the wall, the tables. You can pick up part of the window. Two people sitting together, they look like they're married. And then you look over and people are looking up. That is absolutely all this is that looking around. And the other thing is, don't necessarily try and say, well, this is going to be a good picture. If you have a reaction to it, and it doesn't have to be a big one, take the picture, because probably you're using a digital camera and you don't have film developing on it. So that's all it is, and if you follow those things, you're all photographers. Diane, I am not through.
I want photography. No.
If anybody's got any
questions,
right?
I want to make a
question. I'm bigger than you are. Just raise it. Go ahead, get a question.
I love hearing about the process and all that. What's interesting to me about, especially black and white, is there's so much feeling and a sense of place to it.
Thank you.
Is that something you just kind of creatively just kind of,
okay,
I feel it, I take it, or And also, the second part, a concern about the land, you know, it's all about the land, but I didn't hear that.
You picked up the whole thing right there. First is, it's a sense, I say it's a sensitivity or an affection, that's a better word for it, it's an affection. That sense of that feeling or something like that. See, I would tell people, I'd say, there isn't anything special about any of these photographs or any of those 1800, but what I would say is, there's a lot of them that are a reflection about what I happen to feel at that time about that place. Now the other thing too is, and I put this out, if you look, most of these, you don't see clouds, you don't see that, look outside at the day that it is here. So here comes another part that was important for me is, I cannot wait for a sunny day. Why is a sunny day a better day to photograph than an overcast day like this? It's all part of what it really is. So you're absolutely on the mark on that.
Yes. How do you feel about computer enhancements now?
I'm glad you bring that up. It's here to stay. And if you don't know, well, okay.
So and it's especially as an art form. They're showing up in shows.
I know. And I got to tell you that I've got friends that have taught photography and they do it. And I'm very polite about my comments about the digital photographs. But here comes the other part. A lot of people are really kind of going back, younger people going back to black and white photography, and they're starting to understand what that is. And I look and I say, then maybe those of us that are experienced and are older can share with them, because you see how simple the explanation is for what you raised. It doesn't have anything to do with the technology. The technology gives you an opportunity to make changes on it, but are they really necessary? You know?
Well, I have a little one like this. It's always beautiful pictures.
There you go.
And the ones in the class had $1,000 cameras.
Ah, there we go. Christmas present time for grandchildren. Don't buy the most expensive camera, because I've still got old box cameras, you know, looking down. But with the digital cameras, it's here to stay, but don't spend a lot of money on them. Even my film cameras are not what I would regard as, you know, they're not Leicas, they're not Hasselblads, but they're good. No, you're right about that.
Yeah, I
have
some really, really good pictures.
Just have fun doing it.
Catch up with some time.
Yeah.
Michael?
Yes?
Can you explain your aerial photograph? Black and white. This is the landscape right there.
This one?
No, it's right. Now, where is that? What's the exact location?
That was down at the south end of the bay. And there's a little story with that.
And is that Bear River then?
No. This actually was taken probably maybe 600 feet above, but you have no sense of scale to it. You know what I mean? Or what is it? And then, so the distance between here and here is probably close to a quarter of a mile or half a mile. But it was, I deliberately kept that in there. But what happened was is that before I moved down here permanently, I came down, I photographed around the bay off and on over a period of 5 days. I did not have a single solitary useful picture. After I moved down here, I had my tail between my legs because I had done so poorly. But I would go to Portland because I was photographing in the Portland area, and I would go by this formation, and I saw that a number of times. I said, Parker, go back and photograph that. And that's what triggered a lot of the other things. This one, which is kind of a kick, is I was taking off. There was a landing strip that was built 2 miles south of Oysterville, which I always referred to as Oysterville International. You know, it's 3,000 feet on a cranberry farm. And so when I talk to people back east, they say, where are you located? I said, well, I live in Oysterville, and it's at a population of 12, and I fly out of Oysterville International. When you get talking to somebody on the East Coast, and they go, what? And then you'd say, look, it's a grass strip. But see, this is another part of it. Oysterville, population of 12, strip 2 miles south, and I can photograph all over the country. At a really very modest expense. But this one was no setup, Shelley. I just took off, and as I looked over, as I I turned left and I looked over and I said, holy mackerel, because I could see the reflections and everything. And I turned around and I just fired up one shot and went north.
I just wanted to say about the one that she was asking about. What struck me is in nature as a whole, that I could be, it's the bay, but it could also be a piece of kale. That's right.
What you're picking up is identically what I was doing. I have others, not necessarily the bay. And then I have one last story. There is another one that I would say would be comparable to this. There's a wetland out by Sobeys Island that I'd gone to photograph a commercial assignment. The weather was bad. It was overcast again. I said, oh no, it was the fifth time I tried to shoot this stuff in Vancouver. And so I looked down and I've just got Ektachrome, which I just used because I could get it in the lab and out in a couple of hours. And not much light, I just upped the film speed and I came around and I looked and here's this stuff and I go click. I'm not excited and I go home and it comes back and I look. That one's in a museum collection back east and just, and that was another thing, which you never really know exactly what it is. The other part of it was, I'd always said there was a print, and the print is about this size. I never, ever made a big print for myself. Of all the photographs that I'd taken, that one probably had given me the most mileage. And, but I didn't have a print. Then Dick and Brian are over in Astoria one time, I think, and then Dick said something about, we saw one of your aerial photographs over in Astoria, and I'm thinking, really? I said, what is it? He said, well, it was a big one. And they had a small print of it. And this is like on a Friday, and I'm thinking, I don't know. It's a big print. How could it be there? And I go over, and there is a print. It's my print, and I walk in, and I see it. And there's no way that I see it. So the woman comes over. I got there right when they opened. It was about 1 o'clock on Saturday morning. And I went, oh, this is kind of interesting. Of course, she's there. And I said, really, where did this come from? She said, well, we opened the shop. We had some people in Portland that were buying items for us. And this was down by the Maritime Museum. And she said, there were more. I said, more aerial photographs? And she said, I didn't understand that. And what I never did know what it was. I said, well, you know, I have to tell you, the price was $45. And I looked and I thought, holy mackerel, I mean, that wasn't even printing cost for me to do that. I had no idea where it came from. And I don't think I ever made more than 3 or 4 of those prints. And maybe not that many, maybe there were just 2. How did it get to Astoria, Oregon? And I got it at home. I was going to bring it, but it's parallel to what you were talking about. Mm-hmm.
Well, did you get any money out of it?
Did I?
How can they sell something of yours?
I had given it to somebody as a gift, as near as I can figure out. And I think I know maybe where it's going.
I'd like to make a comment. Mike Parker has done the peninsula of real service ever since he's been here. When he was flying out of Oysterville International, he made photographs that you couldn't get from any government service because they were taken in a different way than just shooting straight down. You could actually see the peninsula as it truly was, like And the state agencies have used these things for fight against apartheid. The county has used them as a record of what is actually happening on the peninsula, how much wetlands we have, how much we should protect, and a lot of other things. And this is all done, as far as I know, pro bono by Mike. So we owe him a pretty big bit of gratitude for doing it, because the peninsula, as I think everybody here agrees, that it's a special place, and somebody's gotta step up and be able to protect it. And without a photographic history, that's very hard to do when you've got so much brush to hide projects.
One last comment, because Diana, she's got things to do, but I have to add to this. When I came down and I met Dick, it was on the 29th of December in 86, coming back from Seattle. It was the attitude that he had, and I had done battles in Portland, and I hadn't been involved in any kind of conflicts down here, but when I saw what the threats were, I started thinking in that last month, what would happen if there were two like-minded people that had two different backgrounds, and so I made the decision to move permanently. But the other part was, I didn't know about any of this stuff, dealing with what the ecology was and the environmental issues and the rest of it. And so I'd go talk to Dick, and he'd say, we've got to go pick up tubs, why don't you go with me? So I'd go down on the May West on their old dredge, and Dick told me one time, he said, I can run the dredge and everything and still talk. So I used to tell people that the oyster dredge, the Maine West, was my classroom to learn about Wolpa Bay, and Dick Sheldon was my professor. And so I've always looked at it, because I was not even remotely have understood the kinds of things that the oyster growers understand. And Dobby and Lee Weigert and Dick, I'd say, had a big influence. And when I say Dobby was the one that was always talking about the affection for the area. So
before we thank Michael for being here, finally, I would like just to say that this whole lecture series was begun as an opportunity for the community to celebrate the stories of our people. And we were to offer enrichment through education, entertainment, and encouragement. And my feeling is that we, even as older people, can be really encouraged by this idea of look for the surprises. There's probably a lot of surprises left for the rest of us too, and I think Michael has given us a good example to go for it.
Yeah.
So thank you very much.